Over 10% mentioned something for older children. When we asked about adult age groups, you had more comments, more suggestions. 15% had suggestions for 19 to 39-year-olds, 16% for 40 to 59-year-olds, and 17% for adults age 60-plus. A lot around events, a lot around fitness, a lot around activities, walking programs, swimming classes, dance, yoga, Pilates, enrichment programs, a wide variety here. So getting back to what I was saying about how things really dropped off in terms of programming that people use, it was mostly fitness and a lot of kids things. I think, again, this supports the idea that there's a big opportunity here for more adult programming. We wrapped up the survey by asking people, when you need information about the park district, program, event, facility, where do you go? They could give multiple responses. The good news is that you're coming to your sources. They're going. They go to the program guide or they're going to the website. If you've ever thought, boy, wouldn't it be nice to get rid of the program guide and not have to deal with all that printing and mailing cost? I'm the bearer of bad news. You can't get rid of the program. People use it. We did some focus groups out in Batavia last year. And we got on this question about the program guide versus the website. And one attendee clarified it to me. She said, it's the difference between buying and shopping. If I'm buying and I know what I want, I'm going to the website because I know exactly where I need to go. If I'm shopping, I get that program guide and I'm looking at it page by page. Well, this looks interesting. Let me go here, that. And I'm going page by page. Well, that looks interesting. So I think they use them very differently. The website, they know what they're looking for. Program guide or shopping. The one thing here is other district mailings came up at 26%, but over a third of the people are going to the village for information about the park district. They're calling the village, they're going to the village website. So if there's a great deal of shared information between the park district and the village, that's all great, but if people are going to the village but not getting all the information or accurate information about the park district, that could be an issue. And then we ask as a follow-up question, that's what you use, what do you prefer, what's your preferred if you had to choose one, and this is where you can't get to the program. It's too valuable. Yes?
I have a question. You said that the program guide is very important. A lot of people like it. What are the age groups for those people that said that?
I don't have it off the top of my head. Oh. If there are differences, it's in the report. And then finally, we wrapped up with one final open-ended question. Do you have any other additional comments or feedback, anything else you'd like to share? With the park district, half of the respondents in the representative survey said they did. One out of five said, again, more, better programs for the park district. 19% administrative suggestions, better communication, better marketing, better service were the things that came up most often there. 14% said the pools. And those were pretty evenly divided, mostly between St. Para pool or we need an indoor pool. And then of that 51%, another big response, and 15%, their additional comments were along the lines of, you guys are great, keep doing what you're doing. Everything's good. That was it. Any questions?
I have a question not for you so much as for Jeff. But you know, you brought it up when you were talking about the pool, power pool, it's not an option to fix up the way it is or whatever. But I don't want to point the finger, but it looks like nobody really planned for the maintenance of power pool. You know, where's the big nest egg or something? I mean, I don't know how many problems that you have that you didn't account for, but you know you have two pools, and you know there's a time limit on how long they're gonna last. It doesn't look like it to me. You can explain it to me. Maybe I didn't see it.
Yeah, as I have investigated some things that we found at Oreo Pool, I can't tell you what the administration, what they were thinking. I can't tell you exactly what the board was thinking. My feeling is that we've had five directors in 7 years with that inconsistency there. You know, there isn't somebody that's kind of looking at the bigger picture. So I can't tell you exactly why it has happened that way, but we're committed to making sure that we do something with it now. And then as we go forward, making sure that we invest back into those facilities, as we talk to Keith about this as well as the board. We have assets, we have to maintain them. So that's something that.
Just as she talked about having a nest egg together, what is the lifespan of a pool like that? I mean, it just could be like one of those things where, it makes no sense to keep, obviously in this case, it definitely makes no sense to keep throwing good money after bad with the shape of the pool.
Yeah, so
but they might have a lifespan no matter what you do. So, I mean, are we kind of at the end of that pool life? Or are there pools around that are 100 years old that have been very well maintained or built differently or, different factors there? So.
Yeah, so, I mean, a pool goes through a life cycle, and to extend it beyond sort of 20, 25 years, they put in a liner, that gets you maybe another 10. So we're at 35 years. We're, it was 50 years old.
Okay.
Right now, we're really kind of pushing hard.
In lieu of this board, remember, none of these people sitting on this board were here previously.
Oh, yeah.
This is a new board. But number one, I hate to see a building being built on that site. That's number one. Number two is that you have two ballparks out here. The second ballpark I've never seen used. So if you choose to go to a rec center, and since this is your headquarters, I think putting the rec center out there makes a lot more sense than over there. So that's just my comment.
I agree. I've been born and raised in this town. I swim in the pool, and I get it. But when, like you said, you guys were not on the board, that's the previous board, and what they took out bond, and now you have to pay back this money. No one ever asked us about Oreo, the repairing. And like you said, it made no sense. A pool that's maybe, 20 years old compared to a pool that's 50 years old. And I agree with this gentleman. If you're gonna do a fitness center or whatever, expand this site. And then I get it, the pool needs to be redone, but why can't you just build another pool sort of the same way that pool is? Yeah. And I think a small increase in taxes, if you had a referendum, I can't believe that people would be that objective to it.
I have an opinion on that. I've been living here for 29 years, and my three kids, they're now 26, 23, and 19, and we used to go to the pool. I actually live close to Oreo Pool, and my oldest son actually worked as a lifeguard in Oreo Pool. But anyway, I just wanted to say that it's my opinion. I think this is a small town. We're not a big town like Skokie, Glenview, Niles, everyone around us except Lincolnwood. And Lincolnwood's small, and we have a forest preserve, which we can't do anything with that, And I think that we should have one pool. I'm sorry, I mean, I know we like everything, but we can't afford it. That's why I asked you the question, because I have the impression, because I have seniors all around me, and I'm becoming a senior. Anyway, but we can't afford all this stuff, and I don't use the facility, the pool, as much. But I think
there's the answer
there. I think that Harbor Pool should be the one because it's on the main strip. It gets more people to see it. But unfortunately, like you said, Oreo Pool's already been revamped and we have all that money in it. I get it. We gotta stick with it. But it's just the thinking of proactive ahead of time, not when it gets there. We gotta get it done. It seems like it to me, and I think
should change. We gotta change that. And I know we like two pools. I do too, but can we afford it? We have to think about that.
Can I say something? You know, and that's, I think what this is right here, and what we're doing now is proactive thinking to make sure we don't get into this situation before. But, you know, I can empathize too. I mean, myself, my first job was Memorial Pool when I was a kid. I swam there too, and I think the need for, if you stick around, I think you'll see as far as being able to afford it, what's affordable, what's not affordable, plans that are laid out and how to do that. I think it's pennies a day, you know, throughout the year. And that's the situation that we're in now. You know, we can't go back, right? We can't go back and say, you know what, I would agree, Memorial Pool is a tough design. You know, it's, and I would, the survey says it, but we can't go back. We can only move forward.
Just the larger question about the whole thing then. Is the board proceeding, because you can't second guess what happened in the past. You don't know what happened there. Are we as a community and as the board looking at longer term strategic planning for everything with 5, 10, 15, 20 year plans, or is this part of the plan? Is it happening as
a pool? Just the one-off?
No, I don't think the pool is just the one-off. I'm asking though, are we like, something like this, is this like being translated? Because I've only been in two other board meetings for this particular board in the past. Is it something though that, long range planning for it in a way that doesn't look like it was really handled in the past?
Absolutely.
I would assume it was. I just wanted to ask. Because it looks like this is part of it.
We are definitely doing that. That's why we're looking at this building and the efficiencies here to incorporate that at that time.
So, okay.
Yes, we're going to expand this building, but to where, and we have a partial efficient building, and the rest is, we can't exactly build something in the back and tear this down to put parking.
Yeah. I'm talking throughout the park district system.
Absolutely. That's where a lot of our time was spent early on. And all
because it doesn't seem like that was in the past, and that's not on you guys. I mean, of course, it's why you're here now, and I hope I'm not hurting anybody's feelings when I say you're cleaning up some messes from other people, too. So
let me just, two things on that. One, we do have a strategic plan, and we got one in effect that goes until 2022.
Okay.
Prior to that, we'll do another 5-year strategic plan. And there was second on the
website. I'm just wondering, like, 5-year almost seems, in my mind, 5-year for a community of this size seems short.
We're looking for things to concentrate on those 5 years.
Okay.
That's why we do it. The plan is to do it every 5 years because, you know, things come up.
Things change.
A lot of this is on there, but the stuff that we have to do to make this happen isn't. So, you know, it's always evolving. And the second thing I want to say to that is, we'll talk about next steps, about what we want to do with that. So, anybody else have any questions for Jeff? Because I'm going to, there's no reason for that.
I may have missed this, and I apologize if I ask a question. How many households were actually mailed in the survey?
It's like 5,000 or 6,000.
And only 420 responded?
Yes.
Is that a typical response?
It's actually higher than
that. That's a good one.
Again, we were looking for a minimum of 300. So, it's almost 50%.
And are you looking at any of the data from the other 417 that responded on their own?
We haven't reported. The thing with the other 417 is we don't know who they are. Somebody could have gone in and completed that survey 20 times. So, but other people provided valuable and important feedback on that survey. So that's why we're sharing the responses with the park district. But we don't know how representative that group is because there's no way that we can really get a group there. So we focused on the grants.
Well, I just so I can understand, it sounds like we're not going to be, or it sounds like most people are saying, let's not get rid of our pool, build it, make it parking lot, right? So does that mean like the next steps are like figuring out, you know, what to do with this if we are to make this new pool?
We'll talk about that.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe not in detail that you want, but sure.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now's the time to fast. Glad to have you on speed.
Yeah, questions come up.
Are these numbers on the website too?
The board packet with this material is on the website.
Okay.
Okay, sorry. Okay, this is just really brief, but this is something that, you know, we went and talked to Chuck Bowling, who is with GovHR, who also was the executive director at the Green Park District, as well as the Glenview Park District. We've used them numerous times over the last few years, and we asked him to develop some next steps. The first part of that is the survey. So, some things that we also kind of looked at is we have some referendum considerations that we have to take in. And discuss, kind of figure out what is the best option for that. We talked extensively about a community task force that would consist of 15, 20 members of the community trying to get a cross-section of all demographics. So that would include, you know, pool users, non-pool users, realtors, business people, that sort of thing, to help, help us with the planning process or trying to figure out what we want to do with a project. And then kind of determining consultants, because once, you know, it's once we have this in place, we still need to think about certain elements. You know, there is an educational research component of this, as you can tell. There's some people that don't even realize that there's a problem with this, and it seems to be a little bit across the board as to what people want. So someone that would be able to help us develop materials to get the word out, an individual to work with the community group, maybe use focus groups, maybe through an additional survey. We have to look at legal. You know, what are some of the things that we have to consider about if we are going to pose something on to a referendum? What are our requirements for that? What kind of things can we do in that aspect? Financial? Yeah, we could do a project, but does that necessarily mean that we can afford whatever the end result may be? So we have to put that into consideration. And that certainly will take time. Architectural, I mean, once the task force has come up with a plan, we'll work with an architect to come up with concepts as well as some cost estimates, that kind of thing. Bonds, since we were talking about general obligation bonds or whatever type of bonds that we're going to ask the community to support, we need to get clarity on what that means for them. And then once we get all that down, then we kind of look at, you know, if we, something didn't pass, then we have to look at project plans. If it doesn't pass, we have to come up with some considerations. Where are we going to be? Okay. So when we look at referendum considerations, just talking to members of the board, really two dates have come up, and that is April 29th and March 2021. Those are the two times that you can do it. You could extend it into November of 2020, but we haven't talked about that, and it does, you know, to be honest with you, 2019, we'll talk about that in a moment. One, if we did decide 2019, that really puts the pool out, possibly just one season. If you go into March 2020, definitely out one, maybe two more, that sort of thing. But some considerations that we really need to, let me pick up my poor spelling. Timing. As you can tell, there's a lot in the back here. You know, all of this is going to take time. You know, and between now and April is 6 months. Maybe not a lot of time to do all that. Can it be done? I've talked to an architectural firm. Said, you're paying for it. We can get it done. But we're going to have to cut corners. We certainly won't be able to do a lot of public input on that. That sort of thing really puts us we're, you know, under the gun here, because although you have until, I mean, the election is in April, but it has to be on the ballot, it has to be submitted to the county in the third week of December. So you really only have 2 months. Okay? So the timing's an issue. We've always said that we need community involvement. If it's from a playground to something this large, we want public input. Why we went and did the survey, because we've said numerous times, it's not my facility, it's not yours, it's the community's, the facility or project. We need to have their involvement. Some electorate considerations. It went into April 2019. It is an off election year. Typically, what you see, we've had the voter analysis done, and really kind of shows that in April you have an older, more conservative, fiscally conservative group. I think we saw the last 13, 15, and 17, 80% of the electorate that voted was over 55 years old. Something that we would, push against the wind on that one, trying to get the word out, doing, get out the vote at those backgrounds. And then communication concerns. There's a lot of emotion involved in our vote. I get it, I understand it, when they just took away my childhood school, and I was devastated about how could you do that, but what came out after that was something that I got adjusted to. But we have to communicate. And we can see that what I think Jeff said, like 40%, if not a little bit more, didn't even know that there was a problem with carpool. So that's gonna take time to really get the word out, and using some of the consultants back there to do research and things of that nature.
I mean, do you have an idea of, like, as far as with passing a referendum, like, do we have an example of, like, a neighboring town or community and how long it took? I mean, is it more the educational component of, that's going to take the time? Is it more, I know you said the architects can draw up the plans, but is it more the community involvement that we need so that we don't run into another situation where we spend all this money on a pool that's too small and not laid out, right? I mean, what is it that takes the time to do
that? Yeah, what is the community
involvement? On the ballot, but is it that the winter season's coming, there's not going to be enough time to educate people and be out and do all that?
Yeah, and when you're scheduling meetings, especially if you do decide to do 15, 20 individuals, trying to manage those individuals and trying to find dates, that's going to be difficult. And when I reached out to the architectural firm and some other people, as well as some other executive directors, they were all rather surprised that we were even trying to go for 2019. Marty and I attended a session at IPRA in January, and everybody there who passed successful referendums, that was Lake Bluff, Gurnee, and specifically West.
What about Glenview?
But Glenview just passed theirs. I mean, that was 17 million. That passed with 64% voter approval. That word got out that was like 17 million for one facility. They worked with consultants to make sure that would pass. So certainly, stuff that everybody was very surprised when I said that, we're going to try to do April. They were like, oh.
Is the educational component, though, is that what's most important? I mean, getting the community to understand why we want to pass this
race. Right. Yeah, because they're going to want to know what that increase in their property tax is paying. Yeah.
I feel like it's a hot topic right now that I don't do referendums for a living at all, but as far as the community goes, I mean, right now it's a hot topic. It's been a hot topic since the summer. You got over 300 people on a Facebook group. I mean, there's people out there that want to help. They want to help preserve the pool.
Yeah.
I mean, I think putting it off, I feel like if anything, that might be more.
Well, and that's the crazy thing, because we met and we talked about how we are not able to sell a referendum. That we have to stand back from it. If expect, or we would hope that maybe people from the Citizen Task Force or the Facebook group page, would be willing to do that, you know, because that's something that they're going to have to go out and, you know, posters and literature,
yeah,
all these kinds of things,
you're
that
right,
get out the book, stuff that we're not going to be able to do. And in that short period of time, I don't know if that can really be done. Yeah.
Well, that's what those other 470 people are ready to do.
I can probably name them. Yeah, I understand, but let's also understand the electorate. You've got 80% of people that are most likely going to vote in 2019 are 55 years and older. You're pushing against that headwind there. If you look at that time frame, that is going to be typically people that aren't going to support that. You're looking for people that would, and 2020, when you've got the presidential primaries out there, people are coming out. The voter analysis that we had done, they're like, this is your best time, and that is March of 2020.
Yeah. Can I just say, we appreciate your support immensely. Don't take that the wrong way. We, as a board, want to do this the right way and get as many people involved and input from all aspects of the community, all age groups. Again, there's a lot to consider. We have the age of this building, what potential is at that other piece of property, and to do it right so that we're not going through this again in 10 years with this facility. So it's a long process to do it.
Right, and it does set the course for all other future decision making that we're going to do. We're not going to have another situation where we had Ori. They had some public input, but not enough, right, in my estimation. But that's kind of like, we want to know that we're, we have a plan, we have a process, we're going to, be diligent and make sure that we bring, the community along every step of the way.
You said you have a plan, and we're talking about possibly being able to get this on the ballot in December, even though that's not the best timing. This, to me, says you already know which route you're going. Is that true?
Well, that is, I haven't heard from all the board as to what they think that, is the best community.
Commissioner Mano was saying that talk about this building, and so are you guys already moving forward with a new facility rather than?
No, nothing.
The survey results just came out, so that's part of those questions that were in there. We have not really discussed the results as a board yet. It's kind of still up in the air. Again, that's why we're going to take the time to maybe look at March 2020 as opposed to April.
Yeah, and that task force, that's the group that we want to drive a project. Here's the survey gap. This is what the community says that they want. What do you want to do? Do you want to do some indoor gym space or a walking track or an advanced or a new fitness center? Or do you want to just go back to another pool? That's really kind of what Jeff has been saying. There's more support for the indoor pool than the outdoor. So, but taking it to the community and saying, okay, here's the results, here's what it is, what do you want to do? Yeah.
Nowhere in the discussion this evening when you started talking about the referendum have definition come out on what the referendum is. So irregardless of what option you're planning, my understanding of the referendum is you have to know what it's going to cost.
Yeah.
You cannot go out to the public and ask for a referendum with an open-ended figure. So if you want to replace what you have right now, if it's $10 million, you're only asking for $10 million. If you want the rec center with all the bells and whistles and everything else, you're asking for $25 million. So in my mind, to get those plans done, to get things that I've seen throughout the community done, it takes time.
Right, or else you run to another order.
And once you have that known, you guys can't sell the idea. You're looking for a community-involved group to sell the idea to the community.
And I can't see you getting it done in 2 months.
Yeah, and then you combat that with, you know, the voter population that comes out in that time. So it's like, I think, to what Commissioner Mann said, it's just really trying to make sure that we do it right and have the best chance for it to pass, because if it doesn't pass, then where are we at? You know, then we have no money, and then we can't. We'll be filling it in, and that's, you know, that's the exact opposite of what us and the community wants. So it's like, we could push it, right? We could try and push it, but then.
What are you gonna name them?
Exactly.
Will you not be opening the pool in the future, like this next season or until this is resolved?
We know what we want is, what we're gonna do is in the spring, we'll assess it. And because we don't know what the winter is gonna bring, you know, things could happen. I can't tell you honestly, just to say that if it was, it had been 2019, it's this in same condition as 2018, we can open it.
It's just getting worse as the years go on. So you can go by there now, look through the fence and see something for yourself. The only thing holding that thing together is the water and the pressure against the home.
That's still in there.
It's still in there.
So real quick, because I have to leave, because I have a 1.5-year-old and I do appreciate everyone's zest for reopening with you. My kid, I want to use her sooner rather than later, but I feel like in some of these going until 2020 and doing the proper analysis, because you say something like an indoor pool, well, what's the operating cost? What's the overhead? You can build it, but how do you maintain it? And these are investments for 30 years, and I get it, and I'm super excited to do something in this community. I'm new to it. We've only been here 3 years, and I moved here because I have friends that grew up here. So I think it's worth taking a moment to do something correctly, because I think everyone's excited about it. You have every different generation, population, whatever you want to call it, that have responded to this, and I think you need to adequately take the time and work with the architects and work with a contractor and do cost estimates. And it's not just building it, it's operating it, and you're making a 30-year investment. So I think waiting 2 years to do an accurate assessment of how you're going to maintain it is in the community's best interest
and what the community wants, you know?
Agreed. And you guys already said you're probably not filling it, and it's clear by that. And I think that's what a lot of people's maybe anxiety is, at least from what I've been small hearing. But I think you need to involve those four people to campaign for a referendum. It doesn't happen with the five of you and the full-time staff. So that's my input, is give it the due diligence that it deserves. It's going to be a costly project, not just to build it, but to operate it. So make sure it's going to add value to the residents, and we're actually going to use it, right, for 1.5-year-old, or we'll be 3 at that point, all the way through your 6-year-old or your active adult generation. So, I mean, I think you guys are on the right course. I think you need to employ everything that, you know, Chuck Ballmer is going to be asking you to do.
And, you know, one example, I think, too, if you can use Pioneer Park, you know, the renovation we just did with Pioneer Park, we went out to the community and really tried to take input in it. And I think we came out with a park that kept the old feel to it, but yet still gave it a nice facelift, if you will. And I think that's kind of a benchmark.